Hey, this is Steve from Unexplored Films here, and today we are talking about how to create digital set extensions for miniatures. So this is a good trick to try if you're working on a project that involves miniatures or models, but you really want to make the world seem bigger than what you actually have available. Now, as always with filming miniature models, they are probably not going to look 100% realistic unless you can invest a lot of time and money in getting and setting up some very large scale models. It's very hard to fool people that these are full size. So this might be a better effect to try if you're a filmmaker working on a project that doesn't disguise the fact that it's using miniatures, and is deliberately using them to not completely look like real life. Now, I've been experimenting with filming miniatures for quite a while, and by getting the camera low to your subject and adding some movement, you can really do some fun stuff. Like a lot of the effects I try, this is another way of how to tell your story using what may already be available to you, and not spending a lot of money. And if you're enjoying these DIY effect tutorials, as always, please subscribe and you will get to see some more. So the easiest method for creating a digital set extension for a model is to use a static shot. If your camera isn't moving, this is a really easy way to begin experimenting. This is essentially what old Hollywood films used to do with matte paintings. The area that had been added would line up perfectly on top of the real shot containing the moving elements visible behind. For a nice easy first experiment, you can save a still frame from anywhere in your clip and open this in Photoshop and use this as the background to start your digital scenery. You can then begin to add real elements from photos you've taken and try and find ways to blend them in with your model footage, which might help give the impression that the models are full size. So this can be a nice little trick to sort of increase your production value around your model elements. If you leave the area clear where the movement needs to happen, this will mean the scenery won't step on top of your model. You can then export this as either a Photoshop document or a PNG file, and this will retain the transparent area you've left to see the model through. You can line this up over your original footage, and the model should appear in the gap that you've left for it. You can take this a step further by still using a static shot, but use several layers to add some movement. You can do this by once again exporting a freeze frame of the image, building your digital scenery in Photoshop, and then saving the individual layers as separate files. You can do this by switching off the individual layers in Photoshop and then saving. You can then open these layers in your edit program, I'm using After Effects, but you can probably use any of the main edit programs for this, and then keyframe the layers to move slightly. In this example, I use this technique to give the impression of the clouds moving over the model. You can also save the separate layers as individual files to make it easier to add a separate background and foreground, as I did here, which means the only part showing through to the original model is in the middle. If you add some weather elements, such as the snow here, over the top of the entire image, again, you're just disguising the areas that are actually static photos by giving the eyes some movement to look at in the whole frame. Now, this is all very well for an establishing shot, but maybe you want to move your camera alongside your model. This is exactly what I tried recently for these shots of the model train crossing a viaduct. I mounted the camera on a slider and pushed it along at the same speed as the train to get these shots. Now, if possible, the best method for filming a model that's moving if you want to add a backdrop to it is by using a green screen. If it's properly lit, this will allow the computer to easily see the areas that you want to remove. And if you want to see a previous example of shooting miniatures with green screen behind it, we did some fun stuff with a miniature factory exploding in my tutorial for pyrotechnics using miniatures. Now, we only had access to this model for a day, and I didn't have my green screen with me. And even if I had, the model was in a pretty difficult position where it would have been quite hard to light anyway. So we ended up shooting this model without anything behind it, and decided it would make a fun experiment to see if we could remove the background anyway. So I first loaded the take into After Effects, and then set about trying to manually remove the background. If you can't shoot the model in front of a green screen, you're probably going to have to use either the pen tool and do a lot of manual masking, or the rotoscope tool, where After Effects will try and analyze the footage and recognize the areas that you want to keep and the areas that you want to get rid of. So I just tried using masks for this. Now, this would have been very difficult to do on one layer, so I just duplicated the clip and did different masks for the different objects. So I had the main one for the train, and I had another one for the viaduct background, and one for things like the telegraph pole, and of course this girder bridge thing had lots of holes in it, and this became a real pain for masking out, so don't do what I do, kids, just do it all in front of a green screen. And if I'd had mine with me when I had access to this model, that's exactly what I would have done. So after a crazy amount of masking, this basically left us with the train crossing the viaduct without any background. So next I started to create the digital scenery. I had this photo I'd taken a few years back of this valley, and decided that this could be something good to see behind the viaduct. I also thought it would be fun to try a day for night effect with this shot, which is a trick you can see in old Hollywood westerns where they didn't have enough light to light a scene set during night, so they simply shot it during the day with a really dark blue filter on the lens. I also wanted to try day for night because I thought it would make some of my dodgy masking around the girder bridge a little less noticeable if the background was dark. So for my version, I took this image and opened it in Photoshop and added a nice blue filter to it, and also dropped the brightness right down. Next, I cut out the sky, which meant I could replace that with stars and a moon. I saved the sky as a separate layer, and I saved the valley with the sky layer turned off. This now meant that in After Effects, I could drop in the sky layer right at the back, and then the valley layer on top of that. These could then sit behind my masked out model elements. Next, I clicked on position and keyframed the sky and the valley to slowly move in the same direction as the camera. So we have three different speeds here. We have the sky, which is moving very slowly, and then the mountain is moving a little bit quicker, and then finally the foreground elements look like they're moving faster still. So we're using these different speeds just to trick your brain into thinking that some elements are much further away than others. This is basically an updated digital version of the rolling road and the rolling sky effect, often seen in old shows like Thunderbirds, which used models. Whenever a vehicle had to drive down a road or take off and land on a runway, it was suspended above a conveyor belt which looked like the road. Another conveyor belt which looked like the horizon and the sky was mounted 90 degrees behind it. The road and the foreground conveyor belt was simply operated to move much faster than the conveyor belt with the background and the sky, and as a result, one looks much further away than the other, even though the two are right next to each other. Next, I dropped a dark solid between the valley layer and the train layer, which I hoped would help disguise the join around the masked out elements, and I attached this to the valley layer. Next, I wanted to add some smoke from the train's funnel, and the easiest way to do that was to track the movements of the front of the engine. So I selected the original footage layer with the train, went over to the tracking panel, and clicked Track Motion. This gave me a tracking point, and I only needed one of these this time because it was quite a simple move, and I lined this up over something easily visible on the front of the engine. By clicking the play arrow for Analyze Forward, this then analyzed the movements of the engine. Once I had this, I created a new null object, which is just an invisible thing that you can attach other things to, and then applied the motion from the track to the null object. This now meant that the null object was moving in exactly the same way as the front of the train. So I could now add some smoke, which I used from Video Copilot's Action Essentials, to the train, and I attached it to the null object. So now the smoke moved in time with the engine. I did the same again with a longer column of smoke that would just sit above the engine and look like the smoke was being blown backwards. So then I wanted to cover some of the elements that were in the foreground, like the edge of this trestle table here, which I didn't want to be seen because it just makes it look like a model. So I found some images of a coal heap and decided to add that in over the top. For this, I tracked the motion of the foreground because that would be moving at a different speed to the train, and created a second null object to attach that movement to. Then I could drop the coal heap in over the top and blur it slightly. And with a bit of manual repositioning, that kind of helped cover the edge of the table. I also added some bushes on the right just to give a nice little edge of the frame as the train leaves the shot. Finally, I added an adjustment layer over everything and added the Lumetri color effect to it. Then I opened the Creative tab and selected the look called SL Blue Day for Night. And this did a great job of making my original footage look like it was being lit by the moon instead of the sun. This was another reason why I'd included the moon in the background, because it provides a reason for being able to see the train lit up. Finally, I dropped in some foreground smoke and cooled this right down to match with the rest of the footage. Once again, weather elements that sit on top of all your shots really help blend everything together, and in this case worked well because the train already had smoke coming out of it, and it just made the whole shot look nice and atmospheric. And if we look at the original shot next to the final composite, you can see all the elements that have been added to really extend the scenery behind this model and build a much bigger world for it. So hopefully this has given you some fun ideas about how you can build your own digital set extensions when filming miniatures. So guys, I hope you enjoyed that. Please give it a go, tell me what you think in the comments, and hit that subscribe button if you enjoyed this. I have been Steve from Unexplored Films, and I'll see you next time.